ready?
2 minutes from Mike D. Right. Why did you guys set this up?
Well, I mean, it started like with the initiation of the Milarepa Fund, which actually started back on our Ill Communication record when we sampled some Tibetan monks chanting, and we had to, we felt obligated to sort of donate part of the proceeds to good Tibetan causes. And then we realized we sort of had to deal with it a bit, like actually administrating that and actually making that happen. And then sort of the idea came to do after like we were touring and getting information out there about the, you know, the situation with the Tibetan struggle and the Chinese occupation of Tibet. Like, well, let's do one benefit. I mean, it's really Milarepa that's definitely done a lot of the work and to put this on, but sort of like last year went well, and fortunately so far it seems like this year's gone really well as well.
If you want to hear more details about the Milarepa Fund, I can find you guys on the internet, right?
Yeah, definitely. Just go check out Milarepa on the internet, or if they're calling from this country, you can dial 1-800-MILAREPA as well.
So who was Milarepa, just in short?
He was like a sort of like this.
Famous Buddhist monk.
Correctly, he was like, well, a Buddhist saint in a sense, or a deity, and who is actually sort of. Lessons revolved around compassion through music, so it kind of seemed very apt.
I heard the story that you guys were totally into the Milarepa thing because Adam went to Tibet or went to Nepal to snowboard there, is that true?
Yeah, he was in Nepal, and that's where, because there's such a big Tibetan community there, that's where he got exposed to most of that.
How did you guys get this huge lineup? I mean, the biggest names?
I don't know. It's confusing, isn't it?
I can't understand the Bismarcky thing, though.
Yeah. No, it's just really fortunate that it was able to come together. I think everyone pretty much enjoyed themselves because it's like, you know, it's people are so used to sort of like when they do these festivals, it's usually more for like monetary reasons or whatever. So it's a lot more relaxed when everyone just is all on the same plane. It's all together, you know.
Suppose I'm totally into your thing. How could I join, or how could I do something for Tibet?
Well, the best thing is essentially like two ways. One is with our governments, our Western governments, we have a huge amount of influence or potential influence over China and the Chinese government and the way they're treating Tibetans and with the human rights abuses in China. So it's through lobbying and through contacting and through really working as hard as we can to affect change within our own governments towards that policy. And then as well, all of our Western businesses have huge amounts of vested interests over there as well, so we certainly have like a direct economic kind of like sort of participation in terms of interacting with those huge companies.
A lot of brands are made in China, though. I was checking out my own shoes.
Yeah, no, it's almost impossible to get a pair of sneakers that aren't made in China, you know.
So when are the extra large shoes due?
Well, we source, like with our clothes that we make, we just kind of try and be careful not to source from China, really.
Yeah. Is there any connection between the Tibetan shop really next to the extra large shop here in Lafayette?
No, actually that's pure coincidence. It's literally, it is. Okay. That's the melting pot of New York right there.
Hey, another thing. You guys listed also a huge economic boycott on the internet. Where are the brands which I absolutely must not buy?
Well, it's not so much as I think specific brands, except for, well, there is Bass Ale and there's Holiday Inn, because they're really in partnership with the Chinese government, and so they've built like Holiday Inn in Tibet, and like people go there and they like tap all the rooms and everything. So that is like a direct boycott of Bass Ale and Holiday Inn. But beyond that, I think it's just really a matter of like overall awareness. Like when you go to buy something, well, okay, where's this coming from? And not necessarily is it made in China, but you know, maybe what kind of conditions is it made under wherever it's being made, you know?
So it's pretty bad in Tibet, but everybody, at least in Europe and Holland, a lot of people don't know about how bad it is. How come?
Because it's essentially, I think it's geography. You know, something is far away, so it's very easy for all of us to feel like it's very far away, so it doesn't reflect on us in any way.
Suppose I want to know more, what should I do?
What's that?
Suppose I want to know more about Tibet and what it's like, what should I do? Again, check the net?
Yeah, internet would be really good. I mean, Milarepa can also route you to other organizations. There's Students for a Free Tibet. In this country, we've got a really good resource. So, you know, it goes on and on in terms of resources that are available. I mean, any university, I'm sure, has Tibetan studies, you know.
When will you guys come to Europe with this?
Ooh, I don't know. It's hard enough doing this here.